In this video, we are going to look at several sketch editing tools in Autodesk Inventor, including the ability to move, copy, rotate, scale, stretch, trim and extend, split, and create rectangular and circular arrays. First, we'll look at the ability to move objects. As you can see, I've got a partially constrained sketch right now. The status bar tells me it needs two dimensions. Basically, because I haven't locked it into the origin, the object itself is constrained, but you can see that I can click and drag on it to move it around either horizontally or vertically. You can also use the actual move command. Up here on the sketch tab in the modify panel, I can select move. I will begin by selecting the objects. You can see that button is pressed down already. Then I will select my base point. So I'll choose this button, and then I will pick the point that I want to use as the base point. So I'll go ahead and click the corner here. And as you can see, I'm basically using that as a handle to move this shape. So then I can press done. This can be very convenient if you want to move it to meet something else. So maybe I have another rectangle over here and I want to move this shape to meet it. So I'll select my objects, select my base point, choose the corner, then click where I want it to go. Then select done. I'm going to undo this a couple times and also show you that this command works if you've constrained the sketch as well. So let's say I create a coincident constraint between the corner of the shape and the origin point. It is now fully constrained. You can see that it changes color and it tells me so in the status bar. I'm going to go ahead and choose my move command, select my geometry, select my base point. And when I choose the point this time, I'm going to get a message that lets me know it's been constrained to other geometry. It will allow me to go ahead and remove those constraints. So I will click yes. Now you can see that even though it was fully constrained, I'm free to move it to another location. Once I click done though, you can see that it still needs two dimensions now. It fully removed those constraints. So at some point I need to reconstrain it to the origin or another object to fully constrain this sketch. The copy tool works very similarly. I choose copy, select the objects, select the base point button, choose a base point, then I can click where I want my copies to go. As you can see, it stays in the copy command. I can go ahead and place multiple copies, and then of course come back with some dimensions and constraints to fully constrain this sketch. Another tool that works very similarly is rotate. I'll select the rotate tool. Select my geometry, choose the center point button, then pick a point to be the center of my rotation. So this is the point that I'm going to rotate around. Let's choose this corner, for example. Now it's going to tell me that I need to remove constraints if I want to be able to rotate this. So I'll click yes. Now you can see I am free to rotate it around that point. I can click on screen when I like the rotation angle, or I can type it here in the angle box. So if I knew I wanted it to go straight down, that would be a 270 degree angle. I can simply type 270, then press enter. Then select done. Now that will relax some constraints. So in addition to changing the location potentially, I've lost the horizontal or vertical constraints that were applied to this. So I'll just need to come back and apply some constraints after the fact. Next, let's look at the scale command. With the scale command, I want to change the size of an object. Often, we'll do that just by changing the dimensions. So if this shape needs to be twice the size that it currently is, I can come in and edit these dimensions to twice the size that they currently are. As you can see, I had a little bit of hiccup there based upon the order that I changed the values, but once it's done, you can see the shape is back to where it was to begin with, just twice as large. Well, the scale command will let me do this by typing in one value. I don't have to change each one of these values. So let's say I want to double this one again. I'll choose my scale command, select my objects, select my base point button, then select a base point. I'm going to have to relax the constraints here, so I'll click yes. Now you can see that I can scale the object. If I want a smaller version, I can type in a smaller scale factor, such as 0.5. If I want to double it, then I'll put in a scale factor of 2 and enter. Then I can go ahead and select done. As you can see, it's doubled the scale of the entire shape without causing me to change each dimension individually. One more similar command we'll look at is the stretch command. This will allow me to stretch objects out. So for example, if I wanted this shape to be longer, I have a couple of dimensions I can edit, or I can use my stretch command. So I can select the area that I want to stretch using a crossing by clicking and dragging. So you don't want to go to the right, you want to go to the left to get a crossing. Then I'll select a base point to stretch from. So I'll choose this corner here, and I'll click yes to remove dimensions and constraints. And now you can see that I'm free to stretch it. I can type in a value by selecting the precise input toolbar, or I can just simply move my mouse until I get close to the value that I want. I'll have to go back and edit the dimensions though. So let's say I did want it to be 2 inches larger. I can choose the precise input toolbar. In the X direction horizontally, I want it to be 2 larger. So I'll put in 2 for that value. And now you can see once I line it up horizontally, I've stretched it a distance of 2 inches. Next, we'll look at the trim and extend commands. The trim command is located here in the modify panel. I'll select the trim tool, and all you have to do is just simply click on the portions that you want to trim out. So if I want to get rid of the top portion of this line, I can do so, and I can get rid of the left side as well. Notice that it does add in a coincident constraint based upon that trim. So if one line moves, the other one goes with it. So again, really easy to trim. Just select the portion that you want to get rid of. You can also use the trim command to completely erase a line as well. If you want to trim several lines, you can do this by clicking and dragging. So I'll draw a few horizontal crossing lines here. And then when I go to trim, I can click and drag to create a trim fence. And that selects all of them and trims them all at once. We can also extend. So if I have lines that I want to extend to meet another object, I can choose the extend tool here. And as you can see, it's just going to extend to meet the next object. It's important to note that I need to be on the correct side of the line. As I'm over here on the left side of the line, you can see that it's still extending the way that I want. But what if there was another line over here? Now when I extend, it's either going to go to the right or the left, depending on where I click on the object. So again, I can click each of these to extend them. Let's look at one more example here. What if this did not actually extend to meet this line? When I choose extend, it's going to basically project all other lines and act as a boundary edge. So since I have this line over here to the left, it's going to go ahead and go to that object. I'm going to go ahead and delete this one so that I can show you that if I extend now, what is it doing there? It's actually picking up this vertical line up top and using it as a boundary so I can extend to where they would meet. And as you can see, I can extend again to where this would meet if it were to continue down. Notice the coincident constraint right there. Even though it's not actually touching the line, a relationship has been created with that line. So if the line changes, so will the endpoint of the line that was extended to meet it. Similar to trim, we can split an object. This will basically break it in two, but not delete any segment. Here's the split tool underneath extend. I can go ahead and select a line, and as you can see, it's going to pick up the nearest intersection and split that into two separate segments. The last thing that we'll look at with the trim and the extend is how easy we can switch from one command to the other. I'm going to start the extend command. And as you can see, I'm extending to meet this next line. If I hold the shift key at my keyboard, it automatically puts me into the trim command. And it works the other way as well. If you started with the trim command, you can hold shift and switch back to the extend command. Next, we'll look at a rectangular pattern in the sketch mode. It's important to note, as we look at the rectangular pattern and the circular pattern, these tools also exist in the feature mode. Later when we're in a 3D part, we can use a three-dimensional version of this tool. It's actually recommended that you use them as 3D features when possible instead of doing it in a sketch, but we'll take a look at the sketch tool nonetheless. Here I have a circle inside of a rectangle, and I want to create a pattern of these circles. So I'm going to come up and choose rectangular pattern here on my sketch tab. So that opens up the rectangular pattern dialog box. Go ahead and move it out of the way here. I'm going to start by selecting the geometry I want to pattern. then a direction. So I'll choose the direction arrow, and then I'll choose a line that indicates the direction I want it to go. So my first set is going to be a horizontal row, so I'll choose a horizontal line. I can indicate the space between each one, so I'll go from 1 inch to 2 inches on this one. And then I can indicate how many I want. This includes the original. So I'm going to go ahead and include 4 more, so I'll put in a total of 5. Now if I just want one row, I can go ahead and click OK, but if I want to make multiple rows, I can choose a second direction. So I'll choose the direction arrow and pick the vertical line here. As I can see, it's trying to copy it down, so I'm going to select the flip arrow. Then, very similar to what I did with the horizontal row, I'll change my spacing and my quantity. Then I can click OK. If you want to remove one or more of these, you can do that by suppressing them. If I select the sketched object here, I can right click and choose suppress elements to remove that one. You can just see a construction line basically remaining there. It's also important to note that these are all dependent on the original one. So if I come in and adjust the dimension of the original hole, you can see that they will all update. Finally, let's take a look at the circular pattern. I want to create a bolt circle of these holes, copying it around. So I'll choose my circular pattern tool here. I'll start by selecting the geometry. Then I'll specify a base point. So I'll choose the arrow and pick the center of my circle as the base point. As you can see, I can input a quantity here, and it will evenly space them about 360 degrees. I can also flip the direction, which in this particular example doesn't really matter, but let's say that I wanted 6 of these, and I only want them in half a circle. I'll change it to 180 degrees. Then you can see that by default here, mine's going counterclockwise. I can flip this and make it go clockwise from the original one instead. As you can see, several different ways that you can modify sketch objects. It's important to try these out and practice them so that you can become an efficient sketcher in Autodesk Inventor. That concludes this look at sketch editing tools in Autodesk Inventor.